But my name is Rainer Grimm, as you can read it here. I'm software developer since 1999, quite a time. 24, I started also to be a trainer. I gave a lot of trainings regarding C++, regarding Python. Since 2016, I'm an independent trainer. So I'm just, I make my living by giving trainings. Okay, today I want to talk for me about a beautiful C++ 20 feature, which is concepts. Well, let's start. Okay, this is my outline. First, a short overview, a little bit of history, then a lot of syntax. What can you do with concepts? Just syntax. Then the funny part starts for me, the placeholder syntax in syntactic sugar. This is the stuff I like about concepts. And at the end, I define two concepts, which is not so difficult. Okay, let's start. PantArray, the reason is quite simple. It may change a little bit in the nearest future, so I'm not sure. It flows. Okay. A first overview. We have two issues from my perspective in C and C++. We have function which works on one type, and we have function which works on all types. Both are, for me, the wrong ways. What are the issues? When you have a function which only works on one type, you have to define it for each type. Or you have something like narrowing conversion, something like integral promotion, which you will not have. Why? Narrowing conversion means you can have a double and use it to initialize an int, which is extremely bad. Integral promotion means, for example, adding bool plus bool is int, which is for me also crazy. And now we have generics. They will not solve the problem. What's the issue with generics? They work, and they work also for types which will not respect the syntax of this generic function. You get ugly error messages. C++ is worldwide known for that. Here are two examples. I have a function, oh, that's too small. It's called needInt. It needs an int, of course. And I can invoke it with a double. What I got is an int. So loss of data accuracy. Extremely bad. Or we can do it in a generic way. I wrote a generic GCD algorithm based on the Euclid algorithm. And it works, but not when I use a double, because a double has no idea what modal operation should do. But template instantiation is eager. It will be instantiated, and during the process of instantiation, it blows. And then you have no idea where the error started and when it ends. Two sides of the wrong way. Now we have something in between. These are concepts. A first overview. You can now express requirements to template parameters in the header of the templates. They support stuff such as overloading, partial, full specialization. We now get drastically improved error messages. To put it the other way around, error messages we understand. You can use them just as placeholder. Just as auto, you can now use a concept. You can, of course, define your own concepts, and you can use them for class templates, function templates, and methods of class templates. This is a short overview, but that's not all, of course not all. Okay, a little bit about the history, the long, long history. This was my first impression as I recognized we have something such as concept. I think it was around 25, 26, I'm not sure. They reminded me to Haskell type classes. This was my first impression. I will come back to this picture of Haskell. This is a hierarchy of Haskell type classes, and in particular, you can see here, to support ordering, you have to support equality, which is for me extremely elegant. I will come to this picture later because I want to try, can I do something similar with concepts? You know, the history of concept is quite old. 29, they were removed from the C++ 11 standard. It's a pity to say in Frankfurt, you know, I'm from Germany. And with 2017, Concepts Lite, a light version of them were removed. By the way, here's a site from Bjarne. They evolved into a monster of complexity. They were too complex. So we got with Concepts Lite, but they were also removed from C++ 20, but now we have they were removed from C++ 17, but now we have 20. And now they are in, and they are in the draft of the C++ 20 standard. Okay, now a little bit of use cases for concepts. Just to see they are boring. What I mean by boring? They behave the way they should behave. This is for me boring, but also great, because I have to teach that stuff. Okay, three ways to use a concept. This is the initial version. Here I say the container cont should support the concept sortable, whatever that means, to be used in the function template sort. Okay, there's a syntactic sugar to this form. I can use it instead of type name or class, which makes it for me easier to read, but there's another way to express it. Or, which is, I think, quite new, you can also use a trailing requires clause, such as here. You can specify it later. I most of the time use the first two versions. Okay. When you now invoke sort with something which does not support a random access container iterator, such as std::list, you would get a nice error message instead of an ugly error message, such as before. Why? std::sort requires that the used container has a random access iterator on which you can apply, for example, the index operator, but std::list only supports a bidirectional iterator, which is quite trivial. This was a very ugly error message before, very ugly. Okay, what is a concept? A constant is a constant expression, something which can be evaluated at compile time, and also a predicate, meaning something which returns true or false. And you know what this means? The type traits come here naturally in play. Okay, here a concept used for a class. I have a vector which accepts only objects. For example, an int is an object, so I'm fine. But the reference is, of course, not an object, so I'm not so fine. I would get an error message. Wait for the concrete error message when I show you examples. Okay, you can also use a concept for a method of a class template. In this case, you have to specify the requirements before, or the requirement before. And yeah, you see it here. This concept says T should be copyable to be used in pushback. As I said to you, it's boring, but on the other side, it's nice. It just works. Here, this is a little bit a more sophisticated example, which I created a few days before. You know from C++ 17 fold expressions, I implemented all, any, and none. All returns true when all of the arguments are true, any when any of the arguments is true, none if none of the arguments are true. And the key point is here, I use the concept arithmetic. to express my requirement. Arithmetic means it should be integral or floating point. This is arithmetic. Okay, now I can use it. Here it returns true, here it returns false, because false, of course, is false. It just works, so I can even use it for riotic templates. This was my point, sorry. You can use it for riotic templates. Okay, of course, you can use more than one requirement. In this case, I want to use the function find. The function find requires that the container is in sequence container first, and second, that the elements of the container are equality comparable. If not, nice error message. Okay. But you can do other things. You can also overload on concepts. Have a look. You know this algorithm of the standard template library stood at once. You have an iterator and a number, and then the iterator advances by this number. And I have here implementation for input iterator, bidirectional iterator, and random access iterator. When I now use it with a list, as we know, supports a bidirectional iterator, this version would be chosen. When I use a vector which supports a random access iterator, this version would be chosen. The reason is it's faster. And when I use, maybe you want to use it, a forward list, which only supports in forwarding, what is it called, forward iterator, something like that, this version would be chosen. Quite, what should I say, intuitive. Okay. You can specialize on concepts. You see, this is the generic or the primary template, and here it's a partial specialization for object. When I now invoke it with an object, I go to this partial specialization with a reference to the general one. So all behaves as expected, at least for me, sorry. Okay. Now to placeholder syntax. I have to tell you something. I give a lot of C++ classes, maybe 30, 40 a year. So quite often I teach C++. And I have one C++14 teacher which I hate and which I love. First, the love part. Generic lambdas, they are great. Why? We have generic containers which can be modified by generic algorithms. And you can modify these algorithms since 14 with generic lambdas. This fits together. It's all generic. With 11, you would use a type-based lambda, which breaks this abstraction of generosity. I think it's the right word. This is a nice feature. But on the other side, it's an ugly feature. Why? Conceptually, more than conceptually, generic lambdas are function templates in a different version. They look original, they look differently, but they are function templates. To be more specific, they have a templatized call operator. I reduced it here. They are function templates. What we did with C++ 14 is to introduce a new syntax for writing function templates. You know what my students always ask me in a seminar? Why does this not work for functions? Why can I not just use auto in a function declaration? This is natural to me. And if I want to explain something, I look for symmetry, not for asymmetry. This is the rule. Not this is the exception to the rule. And this is the point which I don't like about generic lambdas. But this asymmetry is gone, or will be removed, or will end with C++ 20. And this is for me extremely great, because now it's all behaves symmetrically. It's quite easy to explain. Okay. What we have in C++ 20 is unconstrained and constrained placeholders. Unconstrained, quite easy, this is auto, as you know it. Constraint is a concept, because you say, should be integral, should be comparable, or something like that. Okay, before I dive into this feature, to this topic, a short detour. I often use a concept, this one is extremely simple. This is the concept integral. I used it by using the type traits function is integral. Who decides at compile time, is it integral or not? Okay, then I apply it in my GCD, and then I invoke it. And what I get here, you see, it's German, but I assume you know what that means. Yeah, at least you learned German. Sorry, can you translate it? Sorry, thanks. Okay, but you see, this is the output of GCC, I think 6.3, using concepts. This is based on the technical specification standard of concepts, not the draft standard, but anyway. But you see, I got an error message because what I did was not so good. I used my double once more, and double is, of course, not an integral. Okay, only for the purpose, because I now use integral quite often, the concept integral. Okay, the rule is quite simple. In each place you could use auto, you can now use a concept. So this was the rule. Here are a few examples. Once more, this concept. Here, this is the return type, integral auto. The first syntax was only integral, but now the official syntax is integral auto, which means all what is returned should be something like a number. To be more specific, something between bool and long int. Okay. Here, my range-based for loop, I iterate above integral auto. Here, the return type or the value is integral auto. Here also, integral auto. And only to show the difference, this is of course the 11th syntax for an unconstrained placeholder. Of course, once more, this is a constrained placeholder. So the rule is quite simple, which is good. And only to prove it, it works. Okay. Now to syntactic sugar. I want to emphasize it. I'm a big, big fan of syntactic sugar. First of all, what is syntactic sugar? Syntactic sugar means you cannot do something new, but in a nice way. Sweet. And I'm a big fan of syntactic sugar. Why? If something is easy to use, easy to write, easy to maintain, it's not so error-prone. So don't look for syntactic sugar, to put it the other way around. Okay, let's talk about syntactic sugar. I start left. The second German word, Fehler, links. Classical. Here, once more, my GCD. Here's the requirement, or the concept. For me, a little bit nicer form. Instead of type name or class, I just use integral. And now, here it comes. Abbreviated function template syntax. I can define a function using concepts. This becomes a function template, of course, but it can only use a restricted kind of arguments, of course, integrals. And this is, for me, extremely nice. You know, I started with generic lambdas, which was ugly. The people in my classes always said, why can you not use auto in function declarations? Now you can do it. Yeah. Not type int, of integral, something between bool and long int. To be honest, this is actually a discussion. I assume they could be different, but I'm not sure with concept CTS, they must be the same. I'm not sure about the draft standard. So can you kick in? This is my assumption, but I could not. Okay, this was my assumption from reading the proposals, but I can never, I had no chance to try it out because there is no implementation for using the new syntax. This is, I'm totally with you, I know it, but I was not new, I was, so you have to answer. So different. Once more, hey, wrong direction, once more. Just use in a function declaration concepts or constraint placeholder, this becomes a function template only accepting and returning types which respect this concept. So first, it's extremely easy to read. You just read the header and you know what can go in. Second, it's extremely easy to write a function template. And now in C++ 20 also you can use auto, which is in this case a function template without restrictions. It just works. And this is for me extremely interesting. If you have any, should we wait for the end or? Okay, I think we should wait. Okay, you see? Looks extremely promising. Okay, I just used it. It compiled, it's GCC 6.3. It's based on concept TS, but anyway. Okay. One additional nice example. You can overload on concepts. I have the function overload written for unconstrained placeholder, written for a constraint placeholder, and written for a concrete type. When I now invoke overload with double literal, int literal, and long int literal, the correct overloads are chosen. Double goes to auto, which is a function template without constraints. Here, int goes to the concept, and long goes to the concrete function. So it just behaves the way it should behave. This is stuff. The reason why this slide is red is quite simple. This is not part of the concept draft. It was part of the concept TS, technical specification. A new way to define templates. Have a look. Instead of template integral T, you just say integral T. What was for me astonishing was that in this case, you cannot use auto here. You have to use a concept. I didn't like it. But you can quite easily overcome this restriction. Once more, you can only use here a constraint placeholder and concept, but not an unconstraint such as auto. Okay. This means this would be fine. This would be fine, but this would not work, of course. This is not in C++ 20. The reason is the red title. This was part of the original concepts TS specification, which was not, which is not used in the draft. It's not part, to make it extremely explicit. I was not sure about this, so I mentioned it here. But only, maybe it will become part in the future, so I don't know. You can quite easily overcome this restriction that you cannot use your auto by writing a concept which always returns true. This is what I did here. I wrote a concept which always returns true, which is conceptually auto, and now I can do it. It was for me a little bit strange, but at least I can do it. Okay, as I mentioned it, is not part of C++ 20, but maybe you are curious. Okay, of course I can use it for int, stud, string, and double. Okay, I see I'm a little bit fast, but anyway. Of course you can define your own concepts, but most of the time there's no need to do it because a lot of concepts are predefined. Here, an idea which concepts we will get. Core language concepts such as same, derived from convertible to, common, integral. This one, I defined it, but I could also use it. Signed integral, unsigned integral, assignable, swappable. We have concepts for comparison such as Boolean, equality comparable, strict, totally ordered. Object concepts, destructible, constructible, default, move, copy, constructible, you see. I will come to semi-regular and regular, I will implement it here. And callable concepts, callable, predicate, a predicate is a function which returns true. Relation, strict, weak order. I said here, you see, modulo spelling. I'm relatively sure they will be written with underscore, I'm relatively sure. But the first idea was to write it with camel case or wiki syntax, whatever you want to call them, this, want to call this syntax. Okay, you can define your own concepts. This is the original version from concepts.ts, and you see it from before, and this is the new version. My examples are all based on the original version from the concept.ts because I have no implementation of the draft. And you see, the braces are gone, the return type is gone, the curly braces are gone, instead of, yeah, you have an equal. To be honest, I prefer this syntax. It's quite comfortable. This is the direct definition of a concept by just using a predicate, by just using a function of the typedrace library. And as I mentioned it, it must be something, a predicate which is evaluated well at compile time, therefore typedrace kicks in. Okay, and that is the other form using requires expression. This is the original version, and that is the new version. Here I define the concept equal. What does equal means? Both types should be the same. There's only one big T. Then I have to support equal and non-equal, and they should return a bool. This is my concept equal. And as you see here, the newer syntax is a little bit more concise. Brackets missing, curly brackets missing, and an equal sign here, and return statement is missing. It's more concise and okay. Okay, let's try it out. Here I have a function r equal. I want to check if both elements are equal. You see it here. And my requirement is a and b must support equal. To make it totally obvious, I defined a type without equal by just putting it to delete. And I defined a class without unequal by just setting it also to delete. Would not be necessary, but it makes it obvious. Then I invoke r equal with an int, and you know, support equal. And in the second iteration, I use this code here, which of course should break, because without equal and without unequal should not support equal. And here, this is the good case, and here, this is the bad case. Sorry, I have to read it. The key point is here, the required expression A equal B would be ill-formed. The required expression A not equal to b would be ill-formed. This is the compiler message. This is the entire compiler message in this case, but based on the concepts TS. I'm not sure what concepts graph will give me, but I assume similar stuff. But it's extremely readable. What should I say? I broke the contract and I got what I deserve. Okay. I said to you, you learn German, now a little bit of Haskell. This is the definition of the type class Haskell, type class equal in Haskell. You see, equal A, it requires equal, not equal. Both types must be the same, you see, AA, and it should return a bool. This is the definition of the type class equal in Haskell. And if you compare this to C++, the concept equal, which I defined here, it looks quite similar. Of course, we have not unequal, we express it in a different way, but it looks quite similar. T, A and B must be of type T. It has to support A equal to B and A not equal to B, and it has to return a bool, meaning should be in predicate. It looks quite similar. Why? You will see in a few seconds, or why I need this, you will see in a few seconds. Okay, once more, Haskell's type class. I wanted to challenge me. Can I build part of this Haskell's type class with concepts? This was my idea. I just want to play with it. And in particular, I talk about equal and ordering. Equal means a type has to support equal and not equal. And ordering means essential. It has to support smaller, greater equal, and greater. So six comparison operators and two additional ones which I will not care about today. Okay, this is the definition in Haskell. I want to show you the similarity. It says, to support ordering, you have, to, if A, in order for A to support ordering, it has to support equality. This is a requirement. And this six additional function. I only concentrate now on this four here. This is the way I would express it in Haskell, which means I can refine a type class. Now the question was, can I also do it in C++ with concepts? Of course I can do it. If not, I would not show it to you. Concept equal. As before, you know it already. And here's the concept ordering. It requires A and B of the same type. Then it requires that T is already equal. So supports the concept equal and this four additional predicates, which are quite easy to read. And for me, this is highly elegant. So I can also build this Haskell type classes hierarchy if I wanted to build it, I assume. Okay, let me try it out. I have here, the function from before, r equal, to say it explicitly once more, this is a function template, and the type parameters has to support the concept equal. Okay, r equal, and here, now I use my new concept, which is ordering, which is stronger. Why? Because I have inside a comparison operation, I use the ternary operator. Now let me try it out. R equal with ints, of course it works. Get smaller with ints, of course it also works because int can be compared. Unordered set, as you can read, they are not ordered. So they may have a problem with my ordering. Of course they work for R equal because they support equality, not inequality. But this should fail, because they are unordered. And here you have it. The required expression, this four required expression would be ill-formed. This is quite easy to read, and you see quite expressive. Once more, this time it says error. Seems to be a different PC. Okay, good case, bad case. Now I had an additional challenge. I want to solve additional challenge. You know, we have the concept of, how should I say it? So I should not say concept. Maybe I call it idea. And we have the idea of a regular and semi-regular type due to Alexander Stepanov, if I'm right, in C++, in the C++ community. And this idea is called regular and semi-regular. These are types which behave smoothly in the C++ eco-type system. What is a regular type? It's quite easy. You need a big six. Default constructor, destructor, copy constructor, copy assignment operator, move constructor, move assignment operator. And in addition, swappable and equality comparable. If a type supports this stuff, we call it regular. If you subtract equality comparable, we only call it semi-regular. Okay, now I want to write a concept for expressing regular. Okay, let's see what we have in the type traits library. We have is default constructible, is copy constructible, copy assignable, move constructible, move assignable, is destructible. So we have the big six. This was easy, or? Of course, I have also is swappable. This was quite easy. I have only one issue. I don't have is equality comparable in the type traits library. I have to build it. Okay. And you see, for example, a reference is not default constructible. Say it the other way around, it's not a semi-regular and of course not a regular type. Okay, how can I do it? This is something which will not be part of C++ 20. But anyway, we have the concepts regular and semi-regular in C++ 20. I have no idea how they made it. I now make it with an experimental feature, the so-called detection idiom. I can detect at compile time. Wait a second. I write my own type trait, meaning I can detect at compile time if T is equal comparable. This means this expression uses this expression. This could fail or this could succeed, and depending on the value, I would get back true or false. This is a way to ask at compile time, does my type support the equal comparison. Okay, now I'm done. Now I can define my regular, and this is quite easy. Here's semi-regular. I create a new type traits by just combining all of them with a logical AND. And then I used in my second type trait, this is regular, this semi-regular from here above, and also my new type trait is equality comparable. Now I have a concept which is quite easy to implement. Oh, sorry. This is my concept, you see? I have a concept regular and a concept semi-regular. Meaning I can now define an algorithm which requires from its argument that it is regular or semi-regular. Besides of this crazy detection idiom, it's quite easy to read. Okay. I'm not sure why I am so fast, but anyway. Most of the time I'm too slow or too verbose. Okay, this was my once more the overview to the stuff I told you. I have to mention it once more. I was totally biased because I'm totally a fan of concepts, but anyway. And here one question which is the subtitle to my talk. Is it an evolution or a revolution in C++? I have arguments for both evolution and revolution. This is my conclusion. Okay. It's a kind of an evolution. Why? Of course, we have auto. Now we have unconstrained placeholders. It's not so different. Constraint, unconstrained. Of course, we have generic lambdas. Now we can use this auto or this constraint placeholders in, to be more specific, these concepts in function signatures. So it's a natural evolvement, so evolution. But the first time we can, the compiler helps us to verify template requirements by using concepts. This is new to me. This, for me, speaks for a revolution. Second, we now get drastically improved error messages. It's also new when you, if you compare it to classical templates. And this is my main point. We can now define semantic categories on arguments. This is totally new. Ordering, regular, semi-regular, equal, integral. This is semantic. When I make a joke during my classes, I say, maybe in the next class I talk about monoids, mathematical structures. This is the first time we can express such stuff in types, which is for me mind-blowing. Okay, now you know what my opinion is. I don't know what's your opinion. For me, it's a revolution. And now we are at the end. A little bit too fast, but anyway. Thank you. I'm not sure. Should someone go to you, or is there a mic, or how should we? There's a mic in the middle.
Hey, if you go back to this previous slide where a revolution.
Which slide?
Just last one before this one.
Yeah.
So the first bullet point for revolution, template requirements are verified by compiler. Technically, you can do this with static assert and type traits.
Yeah. Sorry. This was not against you. I know you can use static assert and inside use and type traits, but you know what I hate about static assert? Most of the times, they are part of the definition. You can put it to the declaration. And when I teach someone and say, you have to look inside to know what's acceptable, what you can use to invoke the function. This is the wrong way. The contract must be part of the declaration, not the definition. It's only a well-defined way to break, for me, static assert. It's not bad. I always explain type traits and use this GCD and I use static assert. And then I say, conceptually, this is wrong. It should go outside. Of course, I can play with Fine, but I don't want to teach this stuff. And now this is, do you know what we say in Python? I also give Python seminar. Explicit is better than implicit. You read it and you know what should happen.
Thank you.
Sorry, I have an opinion, sorry.
Thank you, Rainer, for the nice talk. Nice to see a fellow German here. I have a question. Could you go back to the example where you have this R equal function, where you showcase the
equal function? Okay,
here where you showcase the equality concept.
This one, is this okay?
Yeah, that will do. I believe there's a bit of a caveat here, which goes back to that thing where if you have that place shorthand syntax for concepts, you can have distinct types. So A and B could be distinct types here, I assume. You could have like A is an integer and your B could be something entirely different.
My way, I should use a type traits and ask inside, is convertible to?
Yeah.
No, sorry. You are right. I see your issue. Yeah, right. It's just made it up for this conference, and we have to think about if it's good or not so good, or how can we improve this contract on the type level. You're right here.
Yeah. Right. A second quick question. Can you go back to the slide where you had the four implementations of the GCD function? It's a bit earlier, I think.
The GCD.
Yeah.
I'm curious if you find this argument.
No, it's not. It's not that one.
This is the wrong one. You.
Yes, that one.
Which one? GCD. One, two, or the three?
All of them. So, I just have a general point. So, your integral concept just checks for STD is integral, right?
This is the way I implemented it, yeah.
Yes. So what if you have a type that is not integral in itself, but is implicitly convertible to an integer? What would happen if you try to pass it to one of those functions? It probably wouldn't work, right? Because template argument deduction just isn't smart enough to recognize that your type is implicitly convertible to an integer. It will just say, well, your type is not integral, it doesn't work.
Okay, now I don't know if it's a statement or a question. It's more a statement.
I was wondering whether you agree or whether you have an idea how you could circumvent this issue, because I believe this is not really an issue that you created. I think it's a general thing with concepts, right? They just don't play nicely with implicit conversions or also implicit construction and proxy types and that stuff. Do you have an idea of what you could do?
No, sorry. We have a more serious issue here, which is more complicated. Do you know which one? This is a recursion. The return type switches forth and back, and this is not allowed in C++. You say AB and you return BA. This could be an int, this could be short, this could be something which is integral. This is more serious. I thought this was your concern. I prepared to this talk and I recognized, there's an issue here.
No, I was just wondering about the implicit conversion thing, whether you had
any. No.
All right, thank you very much.
If someone wants to kick in and give the answer, I'm totally happy. Yeah, Arthur, go on. Sorry, a little bit louder.
That's what I was expecting, yeah. I was just wondering whether it might be surprising to some people, because you might just pass something in and you're like, I'm asking that it's something that is almost an integer, and then you might be surprised.
I cannot hear it. Oh, sorry, I got a remark here. You should use the mic, but now...
Should I?
It's fine. What should we do now? Your decision. I cannot repeat it, it was too. Okay, you see what?
So I didn't hear what he said.
Arthur. Okay, sorry.
Would you mind going back to the slide where you defined the two concepts, regular and semi-regular?
Here we are, in this direction.
Yeah, it was like way towards
the end. It was at the end, some It should come now. Here we are. No. Here's the definition based on these type traits. So this is the definition of the concept based on the type trait.
So what confused me, I don't know. Why would you go about defining the type trait separately instead of using requires clause to define the concept in terms of the expressions it's supposed to support?
Please, once more, it's a little bit, I cannot hear it so good. Why?
Why would you implement a type trait to define the concept instead of using a requires clause to list each of the expressions that the concept is supposed to require?
Maybe you can do it in two ways.
I'm happy with that.
I always think about type traits, something which I can do at compile time, but if you can put it in the requires clause and there specify your requirements, you're also fine.
Okay, great. Really happy with that. Thank you.
Maybe it would be easier, or? Yeah.
So,
okay.
I can give an answer.
Please go to the mic.
Use the mic.
So I believe the reason why it's a generally accepted pattern to implement a type trait and then define the concept in terms of the type trait is because you can specialize type traits and you cannot specialize concepts.
The next point is I can use the type traits independent of my concept.
Yeah, that is true. But for instance, if you define a custom type and want to say, oh, this is an integral type, you can specify a type trait, but you cannot specialize a concept.
And the second point was I'm used to type traits since C++11.
Oh, yeah.
Of course, it's not the argument, but...
Are there concepts for working with class hierarchies? For example, can you require the template parameter to be derived from a certain class?
Template parameter derived from a certain class?
Like if you have template type name T, is there a concept that would let you say that T has to be derived from class foo? In other words, the argument has to be part of a certain class hierarchy.
I'm not sure, but you can express it by using type traits. There is a type traits which is called is derived from. And maybe this is your means to build a concept by your own. At the end, you need something which you can decide at compile time, which could be a type trait. And there's a type trait which is called is derived from, and you get at compile time true or false. And based on this, you can build what you want to build. Maybe there's something available, I don't know it, but.
Arthur, did you?
It's like, forget about it. I have it here. Oh, wait. Just listen to my talk. Is it not? No, sorry. Oh, sorry. No, here we are. But I would build it by myself because you always have to do it by yourself. Sorry. Thanks.
Thanks for the great talk. You mentioned several good things that we can get from concepts. For example, we have more bounded quantifications on templates, and we have better error messages and more semantically meaningful codes.
Mm-hmm.
But my question is that, is there any other advantage you can think that we can get from concepts? For example, a completely new paradigm. For example, will we have some kind of concept objects in C++?
What was the last sentence? It's so difficult to hear here.
Okay, so my question is that, what do you think are other advantages of concepts? For example, a completely new programming paradigm. So will we have some kind of concept objects in C++ similar to the trait objects in Rust?
To be honest, I don't know trust to, I don't know trust, so I cannot argue from this perspective. But what I only can say, what I can only now show, we have a new tool. We have to learn how to use this tool, how you build concept, how it makes sense, how we will express semantic in data types. Maybe the Haskell way is a way to do it in a specific way. Maybe this will work for us. I don't know it. We are still in an extremely early phase, so
Yeah, I guess that's my question, because for me, all examples are just quantifications on templates parameters. And I was wondering if there are any other new uses of this concept.
There are any other?
Other uses, like a new paradigm of programming instead of just bounding template parameters. Yeah. Yeah, I guess
for me,
this is a
new paradigm. C++ becomes more and more formal, more and more functional, more and more mathematized, more and more type safe. This is for me enough because, and this is a compile time story. So what should I say?
Yeah, I guess.
For me, this is enough, but we are in an early phase. We have to build the concept, the abstraction.
All right, thank you.
Sorry.
Yeah, so my question is, how does overload resolution work if your type satisfies multiple overloads?
To be honest, I don't know it exactly, but I assume that it will work similar to templates. The most specialized would be used. If not, it would, for me, be totally counterintuitive.
Okay,
this
you.
Is just an assumption, because if not, it will break my symmetry in my head. I always talk about symmetry.
Hi, thanks for the great talk. Just a quick question. Can you do a partial specialization of the template function with the complex
partial
concepts?
Specialization of what?
Of the template functions with the concepts.
You cannot do partial specialization on function templates, only full.
Okay, thanks.
If not, you would have a lot of fun with overloading and stuff like that. Your mind will blow.
So just to weigh in on the revolution evolution.
What's your opinion to nail you down?
Well, I don't know.
Okay.
I think it's probably somewhere in between. But the context I was going to add, and I think Titus is giving a talk, Titus Winters, the LEWG chair, later in the week. And one of the things that the committee has been looking at, right, is that these concepts, once they're published, can never change. So that's a very interesting side effect of concept. And I think the ostensible reason for that is that code will break in a way that you aren't expecting if you change the concept from release to release. So it makes them like immutable. And so the question is, does that occur for all application developers, or is that just a standard thing? And if it's for all application development, then maybe concepts isn't the revolution that we think it is.
Okay, so this is your concern, they are immutable, kind of. Because if not, you break old code. Yeah, we are not Python. Python is more bold than C++ in this regard. Okay. Arthur? Okay.
This isn't a question, this is just more discussion. I think my opinion of that is that for regular, like, industry code, you would think of changing a concept, like adding a new requirement to a concept or removing a requirement from a concept, similarly to adding or removing a new pure virtual function from a base class. Adding a new virtual function, new pure virtual function, would break all your code, but you'd go fix all your code and it would be fixed again. You know, the standard certainly can't add new pure virtual functions to memory resource or things like that. But I think that's more an artifact of the standard than of industry code, if you control your code base. If you ship libraries, yeah, I think definitely it's a problem. Yeah, if you supply your library to others for them to use, Jeff says, yes, that would be definitely still a problem.
Okay, I think we are done. Thank you. Oh, 20 seconds are left, so it was fine.